Everyone, please rise. We'd like to welcome you out to the funeral services for Thomas Lorenzo Putnam. Family prayer has already been offered by Brother Dean Putnam. I'm Bishop Platt. I'll be conducting. We'd like to thank Sister Carpenter and Sister Platt for the music, helping us with the music. We'll begin with an opening hymn on page 136. I know that Larry Deaver lives, and we'll have an opening prayer by Ronald Yates.
heaven. We're gathered this morning to, as friends and family, to show our love for and say goodbye to Thomas Lorenzo Putnam. We thank thee, Father, for the good man that he was and the life he led, and for the family that he bore. We thank thee, Father, for our Savior, for his atonement, and for his conquering of death for each and every one of us, that we might one day be together again through our worthiness and live with thee as eternal families. Father, we thank thee for the love, sweet kindness, and help of family and friends extended to Jeanette and her family and others for this past week and a half, and for the attendance we have here today. We thank thee for all the blessings that thou givest us, and for thy love for each family member. Please now, Father, be with those who conduct and participate in this service, that thy spirit would be felt with them, that they would be comforted and able to do their very best. And please bless us, Father, that we would each feel thy spirit and know thy love for us. Be with the family members Tom leaves behind, especially his wife Jeanette and their children, and bless and comfort them both during and after this service. And this, Father, we ask of thee in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Yates. We'll now proceed to have the eulogy by Rachel Putnam. It'll be a musical number by Alyssa Cruz and Gordon Putnam, "The Lord is My Shepherd." And we'll have two speakers, Julie Green and Byron Putnam, and I'll get some closing remarks.
Born in Salt Lake City, Utah on July 31st, 1964. He grew up in Bending, Utah, in the Sheba Springs dirt. His sisters remember him bringing them home flowers, not knowing that he picked them on the way home from the Uri Cemetery. As a kid, he is constantly taking things apart just to see how they worked, even if he wasn't always able to put them back together. He attended Cottonwood High School, and then later served as mission for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in New Zealand. I remember hearing stories about how much he loved the people and the place he served there. Later, he also served his country by joining the military. He served in the 19th Special Forces Airborne Group in the Utah National Guard as a paratrooper. Later, he married his first wife, Linda, and had three children, Rachel McKenzie, Thomas Lorenzo, and Adam Michael. He attended Dixie College and ran several youth groups over the years. My dad pursued martial arts and had a love of music. I remember growing up that he used to sing all the time. He had such a beautiful voice. In the early 2000s, he met the love of his life, Jeanette Yates. And together they moved to rural and had three children, Rebecca Ann, Patricia Ann, and Michael Warner. My dad had a passion for the medical field and pursued learning by achieving his CNA license and his paramedic certificate. He was a paramedic first responder in the Esplanade Valley. He enjoyed outdoors and camping and hiking and fishing. Pass that off to his grandsons, Dallas Austin and Logan Wyatt. Their favorite thing is going with Grandpa on the boat fishing. Surrounding him on January 12, 2023. He is deeply loved and will be greatly missed. He will be dead.
Thank you.
So
So they opened the door and they came and said, Julie, your brother's here, your little brother. And I'm like, my little brother, that's impossible. He's like, you know, three. And so I went to the front door and there he was standing, grinning, popsicle stains down his chin, down in front of him, naked, except for a pair of training panties. And for those of you who don't know what that is the old fashioned pull-ups, except for it was cloth and we had to wash them and reuse them. And there he was standing with a big green suitcase, almost as big as him. And he was there to join me at the party. And I was like, how did you get here? Of course, we're looking behind him going, how? And he drug the suitcase all the way down the street. When we got inside, we opened up the suitcase, and inside, all there was a great big metal Tonka truck that he drug, because he knew that my friends and I would need toys to play with. So, of course, I called Mom, and she instantly, I said, where's Tom? Oh, he's playing with Karen, and I said, is he? So then, of course, I'm hearing, Rosemond! Of course, they came down and got him right away, but he did. He was into everything. The boys used to do silly things, like I think Byron snuck in the back of a station wagon one night when somebody was going out on a date. And Tom, of course, watched this and saw this, and Gordon tried going out on a date one night, and Tom snuck, about 6 years old, what think about six, snuck in the back of a station wagon with a tape recorder. He was going to go on a date. I don't know how far they got, but he was ready and willing to go because he thought that would be exciting. He was up for excitement. One time, I mean, Tom seriously would pop up sometimes in the strangest places. One Sunday or a Saturday, I think I was driving to work, and I was just coming up with a six South Fire Dogs in Salt Lake City, and I'm driving a little Bronco, and I'm going to be late. I work at the hotel in New House because I am a favorite operator. Believe that. I'm old. And all of a sudden, this head pops up from the back again, and Tom goes, where are we going? I'm sure I screamed and yelled at him. I was probably about 16, and he was, I don't know. He was not supposed to be there. So, of course, I called Dad, and I, come get Tom. So, of course, they came and got him, and I left him out in the truck in the middle of Salt Lake. And then when I started dating, Tom just took everything to a higher level. He would hide in the bushes. He would hide on the roof. He would hide. He would hang out his bedroom window. Anywhere he thought he could hide, that he thought that I wouldn't see him, even if I was sitting in the car saying goodnight or whatever. And he would sneak up. I mean, be anywhere, making kissy noises or kiss her, you know. He was, I could never go anywhere without wondering where he was. He tortured me. And I mean, I can't go into some of the other things he did because his church is not appropriate. And it was funny, I mean, but yeah. Anyway, after we got married, Randy and I went to Lake Powell for a week. We took Tom, he was probably Michael's age. Looked a lot like Michael, had his hair, and he was all buff, and we were in the boat one day. We happened to go past a houseboat full of girls. And Tom's like, my turn, my turn. So we stopped the boat, we got him on the water skis, and he's skiing along and gets right in front of the girls. And he starts waving at them and trying to do tricks, getting their attention, and he gets down, we go back around and drop the rope, and goes down. He goes, no. So, okay, go around. So we took him back probably three or four times, and every time he would get right in front of those girls, and he would crash. And we wondered at first if he was doing it on purpose, but it wasn't on purpose. But he loved attention. It was cute. And he looked cute. I have to tell you another funny time that When, after my second child, our daughter Winter, was born, we were at the house, and Karen and Tom were at our house. Karen was 16, Tom was 14, and we were going to church for the blessing, and Mom and Dad were going to meet us at the church, and Randy's mother was at our house. And we were getting in the car, and she wants to ride with us, and I'm like, but I don't have enough room for Tom and Karen, and she kept handing Tom the keys to her car. And we kept telling her, no, Karen drives. Karen drives, not Tom. Kept trying to tell her that. She kept saying, I want Tom to drive. Tom's eyes are this big. He's not saying anything. He's taking the keys. Karen is like, whatever. And so they get in the car, and Randy and I are like looking at each other going, well, we know he knows how to drive because he says that he backed the car in and out of the driveway, but you kind of see him coming around the corner, you know, many times as he was growing up. But so we didn't say anything. We got in the car and we're driving down 90th South, heading towards the church. And there on 13th West at the light is Mom and Dad in the car. And I thought, oh, please don't see us, please don't see us, please don't see us. And we get past the light, and Tom's right on our tail. And then you hear this beep, 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 and arms just a waving. And I'm looking back at my mom going, and she's just, and of course I can see their mouths yelling, Tom! And we get to the church, and Grandpa Green still hasn't figured out that Tom isn't. My mom and dad are all yelling at him, and we're like, it's okay, he did a fine job, a very fine job. One time, Tom and Karen came down. Tom was living down here, and Karen came down with their kids. Megan and Joey and Spencer were here, and Spencer had this dog named Hooch that he loved, and he had Hooch for quite a while. And Tom walks in, and he goes, okay, let's go. Everybody, we're going to go somewhere. We just wait for him to come. And he goes, come on, let's go. Let's get in the car. Everybody, come on. And Spencer goes, oh, I'm not going to go. And he goes, why not? And he goes, because Hooch doesn't want to go. He goes, who's Hooch? He goes, my dog. And he goes, what dog? And we're all very quiet because Hooch is invisible. But we were very nice to him because, you know, he's a little boy. And so Tom goes, Hooch, we can't go because Hooch doesn't want to go. Spencer says, no, Hooch doesn't want to go. Tom goes, put his hand in his pocket, pulled it back out, and went, where's Hooch? And he goes, right there, and he goes, bam! Hey, Hooch is dead, everybody in the car. We laughed. We laid on the floor and laughed for half an hour. Spencer, I don't think, has talked to him since. I'm sorry, but that is something we will never forget, that for Hooch. And Hooch never came back. Hooch was gone. So I'm hoping Tom is with Hooch now and taking care of him. So will you, where's Joey? Yes, will you please relay that on to Spencer Grayson? Thank you. I have to tell you, Tom, when he was down here, he was so good to my dad, and good to Mom. He would come over on the weekends with his kids, and they would take care of her yard and help her with stuff she needed. But when my dad was really, really frail, Tom would come taking fishing. And my oldest son, Sam, he asked me, he wanted to be here today. He's broken his neck and his back, and he can't sit that long in a car. He wouldn't be able to make it today. And he told me some stories, and he wanted me to make sure and tell them that Tom, not once, but several times, and Sam said to me, I don't understand why I was involved, but he said, Grandpa liked to go fishing in the winter time, and so Tom would take Dad and he'd put him in a little chair or take him out of the truck and carry him like a baby and put him in the boat at Quail Creek in the middle of December. And Sam would get out and they would fish, and Sam said he could barely get his pole or Dad's, what do you call it, the worm on the line before Dad would be catching, and Tom's trying to get his on, and Sam, I called them fishing fools because they fished all the time. That's all they wanted to do. For family members, I just have to add this one little thing that noticed I put something in the casket, and this was for Sam. He asked me, he said, when Sam got married, Tom, bless his heart, liked to prank. I liked to prank my kids, and they liked to prank him back. But Tom took some skunk oil and accidentally put a little too much in their car that they were taking to their honeymoon. And they couldn't sell it when they got done. It was that bad. And they said it was cold, and they were driving to a mountain resort, and it was several hours, and they had to drive through those temples and time. And so if those were happy memories for Sam, but now we laugh about it all the time, but Sam said, please, will you give a parting gift to Tom for me? And I gave him a little bottle of skunk oil. It's in his next tree. It's the lid's closed. It's tight. I wasn't going to put it in, but Jeanette said it was all right. And Tom will understand. So I just want to tell one more little story. This is my story about Tom. This was the first time that I'm sorry if I'm going too long. If Byron comes up and puts his hand over me and pull me back, don't be alarmed, it's okay. When Tom was about 2 years old, I had come home from school and it was just a regular, normal day. And Mom asked me, I want to say once, but I'm sure it was a dozen times, go find your brother, go find Tom, go find Tommy. I could hear Dad and Dee having a discussion in the living room. I don't remember if it was a loud discussion. I just knew that there was some talking going on, and Dee wanted to go somewhere, and Dad said, no, you got to stay here, and I don't know why. Anyway, I think, in the fourth grade, so that would have made me about 10 years old. And I went in to change my clothes, and of course, a 10-year-old, I had a transistor radio, old, and a mirror, so to me it was showtime, you know, I'm just taking my time. And so finally I went out to look for Tom. I did not go in the backyard because we had a swimming pool, and I knew the doors would be locked and he wouldn't be back there. I went to the first neighbor, he wasn't there, and the next neighbor, he wasn't there, and I didn't think anything of it, but as I walked past our yard, I saw the locked gate unlocked and ajar enough for a child to push through. So as I went back there to look, there was Tom floating face down in the deep end of the pool. I completely lost it. It was my fault. I should have found it. I ran to the back door and it was locked. I was screaming and banging on the door so hard. And as Mom opened the door and as I was trying to say what happened, Dee walked past me. I swear it was maybe two steps, it felt like. And he was in that water and had him out and was performing CPR on me. But in the meantime, I had to run in the house and knelt down and I prayed so hard. I said, please, I promise I will take care of him the rest of his life. Promise, please let him live, please, please. And when I went back outside, Tom was coughing and coming around a little bit. But as I learned later, and I didn't know this, Dee wanted to go to a game or somewhere. I don't even remember where he was going, sorry. And Dad had a bad feeling about him going and needed him to be home. Had he not been there, Tom would have been here. You would never be here. That was the first time I think I realized my Heavenly Father loved me because he answered my prayers. But many years after that, I would love to call Tom and do things that would drive me crazy, and I'd be like, you're testing me. You're testing me. It's okay. I can do it. A few years later, though, I have to tell you something really funny. they put the picture, a D got an award, and I'm sorry if I don't tell right, Hot Fast D got an award for saving Tom for, I don't know, merit badge or something, and they had it in the newspaper, and D was sitting down with Tom, sitting on his lap, and now Tom had lost his teeth, and he was grinning and smiling, and D looked great, Tom looked silly, and then when D went back to school, like, the next week, all the girls go, D, I didn't know you were a ventriloquist. That's what it looked like. It was kind of funny. Okay, anyway, I want to close real quick. I just have to say, I love Tom so much. He was always down here. He was my go-to person. I always called him for help. He'd call me for help. Jeanette, I love these kids so much. This last year, Tom and Jeanette asked me if I wanted to go with them on a trip to Virginia. My first thought was, in a car with three teenagers for 30 hours? Are you out of your mind? No, not going with you. But the more I thought about it, it was like I couldn't really say no. I didn't want to say no. It just kept going, yeah, I can do it. I have a really bad back. So I was surprised that I said, sure, I'll go. I'll go. The first hour in the car, it was fine. Second hour, I was fine. Third hour, Tom is hilarious. He had me laughing the whole time. I sat in the back, we listened to books on tape. Him and I like the same music. We just got along great. We did have some rules that he had to tell me about, that I had to watch my language in the car with the kids. No talking bad about anybody, just kept it really good, which we did. It was hard for me sometimes, and I'd be like, oh, and then I would stop because things were kind of out. Anyway, we got to Virginia, and I have to tell you, Jeanette's family treated me like I was family. They were so kind and gracious and nice to me, and they treated me so wonderfully, and Tom wonderfully, and I don't think he felt very good on that trip. So there's a couple of days that he kind of just laid around, and we talked. We had some great talks. But there's times on the way home, he's cracking jokes, dad jokes. The kids kept telling me to quit laughing because they were so funny. And I kept encouraging him, but I didn't mean to. I mean, I thought he was telling me a story, and then it ended up in a joke. But I did a couple of times look at him while I was in the back seat, and I thought, I'm on this trip for a reason. I don't know what it is. Maybe I'm going to die soon. And I'm just glad I bonded and had some time with Tom. I had that feeling so strong in his whole heart. But he had a testimony of the gospel. He loved Jesus Christ. I know he's where he needs to be right now, and he's happy, and he loved his grandkids so much. Thank you all for coming. I want you to know that I love Tom. I know he's happy where he is.
Thanks, Julie. I decided to change my talk to ditto to everything Julie said. Very good. Boy, little did these brethren know and these sisters know that today they would witness a knee fight. I am so nervous that my knees are fighting each other. And before I get started, to the funeral director, I'm really sorry, and I hope your driver's okay. Well, to let you know what happened, this is a not true story. I'm sitting at my mom's house, and I'm talking to the funeral director, and he said, can you come over and we can talk and you can sign some things? And I said, I can't, I'm at my mom's house, I don't have any transportation. He says, no problem, we'll send somebody over. And so this young man pulls up, and I'm used to Uber, I climb in the back seat, he's got the music blasting, and we're going down the road. I wanted to ask him a question, so I tapped him on the shoulder. He screamed like nobody's business, swerved all around, across the field onto another road, stopped as he skipped to a stop and just shook like crazy. I said, "I'm sorry, are you okay?" He says, "Man, I'm just used to driving the people from the morgue to the funeral home." I told you it's a not true story. Our family probably laughs more than not when we tell jokes. Probably. To keep from crying.
Forgiveness taught me a lot.
And you know, as we were sitting there, you know, thinking about Tom and his life, and we're all sitting there, and Dee stands up and says to Jeanette, "Can I say a word?" And she says, "Yes." He says, "Plethora," and sat down. And she said, "Thank you, Dee, that means a lot." Well, Julie's not to be outdone by Dee. She said, "Well, can I say a word?" And she said, "Yes." And she said, "Abundant." And she said, "Thank you so much, Julie. That also means a lot." Then they looked at me like I would say something. Now I'm going, "What do I say? What do I say? I don't know what to say." I said, "Bargain." And she says, "Thanks, Byron. That means a great deal." Well, not to be outdone, Gordon says, "Well, can I say a word too?" And he says, "Yes, please." He says, "Ophthalmology." We all looked at him. "What?" Because that's right, ophthalmology. That means I care. So, to Tom, there's a great deal of us, plethora, abundance of people that have eye cares for you. We all care very much for you, and we love you so much, and you're going to be missed. As Julie mentioned, Tom had a cheesy grin anytime, and you didn't know if he was telling a story or a joke until he got to the end, punchline. And he had that cheesy grin, and he says, and I remember him telling me, "Everybody loves me." I said, "Really?" "Yeah, when I was in the army, they loved me." He says, "Man, they would all come up, pat me on the back, they'd buy me treats, and never an unkind word ever to me." I said, "Really, in the army?" He goes, "Yeah." He says, "I think it's because I was the one that packed their parachute." So that's the kind of okay, Tom was. Now, Tom grew up loving animals. He always had animals. And I remember in the home there at Banyan, he would go out and feed the chickens, and I went out with him once, and I'm a little bit older than Tom, so when, as an early teenager, I was gone. But I remember coming home, and he's out there to feed the chicken, and he goes, "Come here, Barbie, come here, Barbie." And this chicken comes running over, and then all the others come over, and I says, "They all look alike, Tom. How do you know which one's Barbie and which one's not?" "Because they're all Barbie." "Oh, Barbie? Yeah, that's short for barbecue." And of course, you know, and then when he first, I don't know if he was married yet or just he had bought a little horse, and he called the horse, you know, a little pony, and he called it Larry. "Well, that's kind of cool." He says, "Yeah, Larry's short for laryngitis." He says, "It's a little horse." So, and then of course, you guys remember these cows, and his kids remember that. He called them, what was it, Hamburger Patty, and Cow Patty, and Stew Meat. And that's the kind of sense of humor Tom had. He was always thinking of something funny. I would describe Tom as a survivalist. Tom knew how and demonstrated survival skills and taught me a lot of stuff and kind of cool. Tom loved to, hunt and fish and go camping. Now, I remember fishing. I don't know if Rachel remembers. You might remember. Lorenz, I think you and Adam were too little to remember, but I remember inviting you guys to go fishing with me, and I said, I'm going to be up at this lake, and he said, we'll meet you there. And so we get there, and he sets up the poles for the kids, and while he's trying to, he gets Adam set up first, and while he's trying to get Lorenzo's, Adam catches a fish, and he just gets that off, and then he gets Lorenzo's done, then he gets Rachel's done, and they're catching fish, and I said, Tom, let me help him. No, I've got it. He says, I'm going to go grab my pole. I said, okay. And he comes down. I mean, we're off the bank. He comes down with an ice fishing pole. Ice jigs. I go, Tom, we're not ice fishing. This is July. And he just gave that smirk, cast out. Doggone if he didn't outfish all of us. And then he just gave that smirk and said, didn't think it worked, did you? And that's the kind of guy he is. Now, Tom loved to camp. More than anything, he loved camping with his family. He says, that's the best quality time I could ever spend with my family. He says, I love being with them. And you kids know that. Your dad loved you so much. He loved being with you. Tom went on a mission to New Zealand and was around a lot of people that had great faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Through his mission and through his acquaintance with them and through, I would like to say, some pioneer heritage, Tom had a great faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. He loved the Savior and he loved his family. Like all of us, we've all had our trials where you go, hey, that person offended me, I'm not coming back to church, I'll show them. But not Tom. Tom said, you know what? People in the church aren't perfect, but the Lord is. I'm not going to church for the people. I'm going to church for the Lord. Now, Tom taught me something great when Tom worked with me a few times. In his younger days, and I remember working, and a guy needed some help, and Tom ran right over and helped him, and after he helped, one of the other co-workers said, what in the world are you helping him for? He'd never help you. Tom goes, it's not about me. It's about helping him. And you know, Benjamin, King Benjamin, said, if you're in the service of your fellow man, you're only in the service of your God. What King Benjamin left out was, how great is your joy if you're helping other people? At times that we feel like, you know, poor me, I just, the dog died. Eat, work, I just feel bad. You know what? It's not about you. It's about helping others. You'll find as you're helping others, the joy builds up inside of you more than anything. That was Tom. Anytime anybody needed help, he was the first one there to help them. Now, if you'll kind of go with me in my mind, in my mind's eye, this last 2 weeks, as Tom was laying in the hospital bed and his children were there and his wife and family, you'd see Tom rolling his head back and forth, and then he'd stop and look, and then he'd be back and forth. In my mind's eye, he was communicating with those people that were on the other side. In fact, just before Tom passed away, I said, Tom, please go give Dad our sisters, and Grandma Jones at Big Hug for me. Sorry, Lamar, I would like to think I was Grandma Jones's favorite. You probably think you were, but I was. Anyway, and I said, give him a big hug for me. And, but I think they were there saying, Tom, it's time to come home, and he was fighting. I said, well, I can't leave you now. And back and forth, do I come, do I go, do I stay? And then he heard the small voice that said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And it was at that point that he said, it's time to rest. In my mind's eye, Tom, at that point, when his spirit left his body, first thing he did, he went to Jeanette and held her hand.
Held her purse and said, he loved me.
And then he went up to all the children, and he put his arms around them and said, I love you. I think he probably gave you a special message. So as you go through life, as you're doing stuff, say, would my dad be happy if I was doing this? If he would be, you're in the right place. If it's questionable, change what you're doing. Make your dad. Now, after that, he went back over to the spirit world, saw all these wonderful family members and friends that had left before, and they're hugging and kissing and welcoming him, and it's just a joyous occasion. And then as they start leaving, he goes up, in my mind's eye, he sees the Savior. And he bows down and kneels before him and cries at his feet. Savior grabbed him by the hand, lifted him up, and put his hand on his shoulder and said, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And then he held him close and hugged his brother with his brother and said, thank you for being strong and believing and living with us. We're going to miss you, Tom. Have been shining light in our eyes. We're gonna miss that smirk and the laugh. And if you guys don't mind, I'm gonna try to sing a song that we talked about, Julie and I, and I sing it at our sister's house. Sometimes, but not often enough, we reflect upon those good things, and our thoughts always center around those we love. And I think about those people who mean so much to me, and for so many years have made me so very happy. And I count the times I have forgotten to say thank you, and just how much I love you. Tom, I love you. Thank you for being my brother. Put in a good word for me up there. He said, in the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen.
Before I close my remarks, I'd like to thank the State and Ward Funeral Committee for all that they've done, not only today, but for the past month. They've been busy. Also like to thank Hughes Mortuary for their help. I'd also like to take a minute and thank our ward. I got a good friend who believes in God, but does not attend any church services of any kind. And when I got put in as bishop a couple months ago, he called me and he said, you're about to learn about people's faith in God. I said, what do you mean by that? And he says, well, when you ask them to reach for their wallet, you'll find out real soon what they really believe. Throughout the last 3 weeks, no one's been asked to reach for their wallet, but it's not really. Person in this room hasn't tried to help the Putnam family, so thank you. We've got a lot of funerals lately. I should be a professional at this by now, but I'm not. One thing it does is it gets me to thinking about the grand reunion that we all hope to have someday. I had about a 20-minute cowboy story ready for you, but after Brother Putnam's picture that he put in my head of the grand reunion, I think he did a better job than I'm going to, so I'm just going to leave with that and let you ponder on what he said and diddle what he said, I guess. That's what we're doing today, but anyway, we'll have a closing hymn on page 300, Families Can Be Together. Then we'll have a closing prayer by Randy Green. After the closing prayer, the pallbearers will come forward. Pallbearers today will be Adam Putnam, Lorenzo Putnam, Byron Putnam, Randy Green, Gordon Putnam, Michael Putnam, Stephen Yates, and Ronald Yates. Honorary pallbearer, Ralph E. Putnam.
Thank you. Our dear Father in heaven, we come before thee today. This dearly beloved people in celebration of Tom's life. And that's a person we could never forget. He has passed on and been reunited with his sister Heather and Patty and his father and all those who have passed before. And what a great joyous reunion that must have been. Tom has done all the requirements that he needs to be with his family for eternity, and he will be there to greet them, each one as they come through it, with a cheesy grin and a lovely little joke, and welcoming us to the other side. We ask the Spirit to be with us. May Comforter be with us and guide us in these times. And we celebrate Tom as he's gone much too soon. We thank you for Tom and all the things he did for us, and always being there first to help us in any need we have. We ask this blessing upon us all. He will always be with us in his mind, our minds. We'll always remember him and all the great times we had with him. And that he will be there to greet us when we come to the other side. We ask this blessing upon us all, and any blessings we are in need of in this time that have not been proffered unto the Lord, and they be granted unto us in this time. We say these things with great humility. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Let everyone please stand.
How did you get the call here right there with me?
Thank you.